Chapter 2, The New Consciousness and Neo-Ultramontanism, page 23 to 57
of the book Absolute Power by Paul Collins.
Pope Leo XII died in March of 1829, and Francesco Saverio Castiglione became Pope Pius VIII. Giuseppe Albani, whom was his Secretary of State, was unsympathetic to Catholic, Belgians, Poles, and the Irish, who sought independence for themselves. Pius VIII, however, died 12 months in office. The significance of Pius VIII's reign included that he stopped police-state methods and increased transparency in the papacy. He also proclaimed the encyclical Traditionalists Humilitati in 1829, whereby he believed that indifference to the church doctrines, the failure to recognize marriage's sacredness, and Protestant Bible societies contributed to indifference in religious practice. The Austrian Chancellor Clemens von Metternich, the Zalenti, and Albani supported the appointment of Bartolomeo Capellari, a Camaldolese monk who became Pope Gregory XVI. He had an anti-modern stance, who condemned railways, Italian nationalism, and gas street lighting. He used a lot of money in the treasury to hire mercenaries to defend the papal states. The significance of Pope Gregory's reign included how he encouraged missionary expansion, founded new orders, missions, dioceses, and advocated for the training of indigenous clergy, as well as encouraged scholarship, archaeological research, and the arts. He also condemned the slave trade. Pope Gregory XVI died in 1846, with little comprehension of historical forces that played out that century. And talking about historical forces that played out this century, the Industrial Revolution. Most of Europe, except Russia, between 1815 to 1914 became urbanized and industrialized. The population doubled from 180 million to 390 million. The Industrial Revolution helped to breed more support for liberalism, ideas like equality, freedom of expression, fraternity, and democracy. The birth of Romanticism also occurred as a reaction against rationalism and industrialization. It emphasized feelings and the emotional subjectivity aspect of the self, and it had a return to nature. Stemmed from Romanticism, Neo-Ultramontanism was coined by the writer Wilfred Ward. Francois René Chateaubriand pioneered this movement, and he wrote the book Le Génie du Christianisme, The Genius of Christianity, in 1802. This was aimed to reconcile Christianity with the times, emphasizing its beauty, poetic, and intellectual aspects. He claimed that the popes were infallible and never made doctrinal errors and had sovereignty above all others. Another faction that was similar to the Neo-Ultramontanists included the Traditionalists, who argued that through perennial tradition, social stability can be maintained. Joseph de Maistre, of the book De Pape, which is defined as concerning the Pope, in 1819. He saw history as a series of disruptions or disorderly forces that were intent on the destruction of civilization, such as the Enlightenment views. He believed that the Pope was central to cohesion in the West, and that the subjects' obedience to sovereign governments are necessary, for they are in some sense infallible, and likewise the Pope is absolute and infallible. The ideas draw somewhat from the divine right of kings to proclaim the infallibility of the papacy. Louis Francois Valois popularized these views in his newspaper L'Univers, and he became the leader of the 19th century French Neo-Ultramontanists. Despite Neo-Ultramontanism having very little theological foundation, it heavily influenced the coming First Vatican Council. Cuvier's Flacier Robert de Lamennais was a traditionalist ordained priest who wrote L'Indifférence and Matière de Religion, Essay on Indifference in Matters of Religion, 1817. He argued that society was held together by doctrine and faith, and called for Catholicism's restoration in the French state. He also believed that papal authority was necessary in ensuring the right order of society. Additionally, he argued that the church had to be separate from the state, since it had to provide unity to mankind in the creation of common moral beliefs and standards. In essence, the Pope ensured church and societal unity. In 1829, he advocated for the church to free itself from the monarchy, causing commotion in France with bishops attacking him. The context of the time included how King Charles X was overthrown by Duke of Orleans Louis Philippe in 1830, causing Lemonnier to found L'Avenir, or the future. In his paper, he promoted religious freedom, separation of church and state, universal suffrage, rights of parents to educate their children as they wished, and denounced the treatment of Catholics by the government. The paper gained traction in places that struggled with liberation, such as Poland, Ireland, and Belgium. French bishops opposed this paper because separating church from the state threatened church authority, and the French aristocracy disliked this because it spouted too much on liberalism. In 1831, Lemonnier and colleagues went to Rome, branding themselves as the Pilgrims of Liberty. They had a cold reception, however. Prior to Pope Gregory becoming the Pope in 1799, he wrote The Triumph of the Holy See and the Church Against the Attacks of the Innovators, whereby he maintained the idea of the Papal States and proclaimed the idea of the Papal Infallibility in his encyclical. Also, Catholic Belgians and Poles were condemned for seeking liberation from their Dutch Protestant former or Russian Orthodox latter overlords. In 1832, Mirare Vos was written by the Pope, which was an encyclical that addressed Lemonnier and condemned Catholic liberalism, the separation of church and state, and postulated authority did not derive from the people but from God. Lemonnier became disgraced and drifted from the church. In 1834, he wrote Parole d'un croyant, which translated to words of a believer in English, and it stated that the law of God is the law of equality. The Pope responded in Singulare Nos in 1834, whereby the Pope denounced it as perverse. In June 1846, the 54-year-old Bishop of Imola, Giovanni Mastei Ferretti, became Pius IX. He set up the Consulta, or Consultative Assembly, in 1847, and also set up street lighting, railways, limited freedom of the press and assembly. He appeared at first to be sympathetic to Italian nationalism. The context, however, was that in 1848, revolutions had occurred in various places such as in France, Germany, Austria, and Naples. King Charles Albert of Austria tried to take advantage of the instability by occupying Lombardy, and this caused the First War of Italian Independence. The Pope appointed Count Pellegrin Rossi, who cautioned that the development of democracy in the Consulta should be slowed down. This caused animosity between him and the secret societies and the Republicans. On November of 1848, Rossi was assassinated. Pius IX fled to Gaeta in Neapolitan territory by November. A new Roman Republic? Giuseppe Mazzini, a nationalist who was anti-clerical, went to Rome with mercenaries and proclaimed the Roman Republic, which did not last that long. Napoleon III, who back then was President Louis Napoleon of the Second French Republic and nephew of Bonaparte, sent French soldiers to seize Rome on June 1849. On April 1850, the Pope returned to Rome, traumatized by this ordeal, and as a result, he changed his mind and stood against modernity. He suffered epilepsy from a very young age and thus would undergo violent fits of temper, according to the historian Roger Orbit. The Pope had staff like George Talbot de Malahide, an Anglo-Irish man who became the Pope's confidant despite having no pastoral experience. Another was Giacomo Antonelli, who was Secretary of State and convinced Napoleon III to send troops to Rome. He absorbed many of the criticisms directed at the Pope and helped administer the Papal States. The Pope did recognize the new conservative attitude in Europe, as many returned to considering the absolutist Catholic Church a pillar of social stability. The Doctrine of the Immaculate Conception. Pius IX proposed this in December of 1855, maintaining that Mary was kept free of original sin. This allowed for devotions to the Blessed Virgin, the Sacred Heart, the Passion of Christ, and the Blessed Sacraments, founding many orders devoted to missionary work, education, social welfare, and nursing. As a result, this allowed for the feminization of Catholicism and emphasized on the humanity of Jesus and the use of emotive romanticist piety. The historian Orbit states that devotion to the Sacred Heart served as a protest to the rationalistic and pleasure-seeking trends of the time. Risorgimento was the idea of Italian unification and nationalism which was supported by secret societies and liberal bourgeoisie. The desire for Italian free trade zones with standard metric weights, measures, roads, railways, and the breaking down of customs and internal borders, it desired for all these. In the mid-19th century, the Tuscan dialect, which originated in Florence, became the standard Italian language. And in 1850, the Piedmontese monarchy of Turin focused on Italian unification, and the Prime Minister Count Camillo of Cavour turned this into reality. The papacy disliked Risorgimento because Piedmont wanted a secular anti-clerical state that had a non-religious education system. Risorgimento resulted in the Second Italian War of Independence, which occurred in 1859, whereby Piedmontese absorbed Tuscany, Modena, Lombardy, Parma, and the rest of southern Italy. France continued to defend Rome. The armaments minister, Francois Xavier de Merode, defended the papal states with 150,000 volunteers from all over the world. Despite this, all papal territory was conquered by 1860. The Pope left Rome in 1861, of which was defended by the volunteer papal Zuccaires and Napoleon III's French soldiers. The Pope only had the patrimonium left.
Meanwhile,
a syllabus was held in the Catholic Congress of Malines, Belgium, August 1863, where 3,000 Lemonnier followers were present, and Count Charles Montalembert, who advocated a free church in a free state, or l'Église libre dans l'État libre. This congress was denounced in Rome as an attack on the Pope's temporal sovereignty. In September, there was a congress of Catholic scholars in Munich, started by Ignaz von Dollinger, a church historian who discovered where the papal authority had power over history as an independent study. He also discussed theology, biblical, and historical criticism. The Quanta Cura encyclical of 1864 condemned state indifference to religion, democracy, and power derived from the people, and condemns freedom of worship and conscience, the loss of church control over education, the neglecting of holy days, secret societies, disrespecting of the authority of the church, and the fatal mistake of socialism, liberalism, and communism. It maintains the sovereignty of the church from the state authority. Antonelli perceived this encyclical to be problematic, creating misunderstanding for Catholics in democratic countries. Despite this, the Pope was seen as charming and a living saint, undergoing martyrdom as a result of the loss of the papal states. There were large efforts made in centralization, which included the establishment of new seminaries in Rome, having the American College in 1859, as well as Polish, Irish, and Latin American colleges. The Congregation of Propaganda Fide was directed by Cardinal Bernabo, who promoted missionary work, established dioceses and vicariates, and appointed missionary bishops. The papacy increased power in the appointments of bishops, prior of which the local community elected bishops in the early church, and secular rulers appointed them in the medieval church. As secular governments became disinterested, the papacy took more of that power. Papal nuncios gained power in being able to draw up the Terna, which was a list of free priests suitable to becoming bishops. Also, the ad limina visits were introduced, where bishops had to come and report to Rome about their diocese every 5 years. Calls for infallibility, Neo-Ultramontanism at work. Valois of L'Univers stated that we must affirm squarely the authority of omnipotence of the Pope as the source of all authority. Mermelord, Bishop of Geneva, stated that there were three incarnations of the Son of God, the first in the womb of the Virgin Mary, the second in the Eucharist, and the third in the old man in the Vatican. The Pope was referred to as permanent word incarnate, vice God of mankind. Archbishop of Westminster Henry Edward Manning believed the Pope to be completely infallible, and William George Ward believed that all encyclicals and letters by all bishops and popes were ex cathedra and ipso facto infallible. Frederick William Faber stated that the Pope was the visible presence of Jesus and the closest to the King of Kings. Jesuit paper La Civiltà Cattolica claimed that when the Pope thinks, it is God who is thinking through him. All of this served to turn the papacy into a quasi-divine idol cult. As a result, 140 bishops out of 700 opposed the definition of infallibility in the First Vatican Council, and they lended credence to historical and theological grounds. And some bishops even believed that the timing of this was a bit off, since This would alienate and isolate many of the world's Catholics who lived as minorities in Protestant-majority nations. Dollinger was appalled by papal infallibility, writing, "The Pope and the Council, which attacked the papacy from the Middle Ages." This caused a stir in Germany. The First Vatican Council from 1869 to 1870. The Pope announced the calling of a council in the papal bull Attorney Patris in 1867, the 26th of June. This gathered 60 Eastern Rite or Near East bishops, 49 US bishops, 18 from Canada, 41 from India, China and the Far East, 18 from Oceania, 9 from Africa. 35% of the 700 bishops were Italian and 2/3 of the experts and consultants were Italian. 55 bishops from Austria, Hungary, and 22 were from Germany. This led Dollinger to question how ecumenical the council was, since nearly 50% of bishops were either Italian or French. Bishop Strassmayer stated that Protestants shouldn't be called the source of all errors of the day, and also proclaimed that there exists in Protestantism a great crowd of men who love our Lord Jesus Christ. Strassmayer was silenced by the president and shouted down by 200 bishops who never experienced Protestantism. This shows Vatican I had limited freedom of expression. Two documents were proclaimed as a result of the First Vatican Council. This included the Dogmatic Constitution of the Catholic Faith, De Filius, and the Dogmatic Constitution of the Church, Pastor Aeternus. De Filius of 1870 proclaimed that Catholics must uphold teaching from scripture, tradition, and the authority of the papacy, being the original and universal magisterium. This was coined by the Jesuit Joseph Kluschen. Pastor Aeternus, however, focused on the primacy and infallibility of the Pope. The primacy states that the Bishop of Rome was recognized as the focal point of the church, where discipline and doctrinal matters were carried out. The office was described as being ordinary, because the power of the office is not delegated but comes inherently from being bestowed that office. And it was also immediate in that the Pope had direct authority. This is an excerpt of Pastor Aeternus, chapter 3. So then, if anyone says that the Roman Pontiff has merely an office of supervision and guidance and not the full and supreme power of jurisdiction over the whole church, and this not only in matters of faith and morals, but also in those whom concern the discipline and government of the church dispersed throughout the whole world, or that he has only the principal part, but not the absolute fullness of this supreme power, or that this power of his is not ordinary and immediate, both over all and each of the churches, and over all and each of the pastors and faithful, let him be anathema. Infallibility should not be confused with indefectibility, whereby Jesus and the gospel message can never fail. St. Antoninus stated that the successor of St. Peter, using the council and seeking the help of the universal church, cannot err. Cardinal Rascher quoted St. Antoninus, maintaining that the Roman Church, as opposed to the personality of the Pope, is indefectible. Cardinal Guidi stated that the Pope cannot make infallible definitions, but rather the definitions are themselves infallible, and that the Pope had to consult the bishops. Power for the Pope was defined in the context of the Church. Another figure, Prince Bishop Gasser of Brixen, Austria, on July stated that infallibility does not belong to the Pope personally, but only to the title of Bishop of Rome and successor of St. Peter. 2 days after his speech, the bishops were to vote, and 451 voted yes, agreeing to the definition of infallibility, 88 voted no, and 62 voted yes with modifications. Most bishops came to the acceptance of the new definition that when the Pope speaks ex cathedra before all Christians in faith or morals, that he is infallible in defining these. It had in the end of the paragraph, "not by the consent of the church." This was added to reject any form of Gallicanism, and meant, however, that the Pope did not require the consultation of the bishops. Most bishops accepted infallibility in the end, but some did not. Those that did not maintained themselves to be old Catholics, who refused the doctrine and formed a confederation with the Anglican Church. They are scattered in places like Germany, Austria, and the Netherlands. The First Vatican Council ended on the 20th of October 1870, whereby it was suspended under sine die without a date being set for resumption. On the 11th of September 1870, the Franco-Prussian War was occurring, causing French soldiers to withdraw from Rome and Italy, invading the Patrimonium Petri. The Pope fled to the Vatican. The Italians offered the Law of Guarantees in 1871, whereby the Pope could have possession of Leonine City, Castel Sant'Angelo, and the Vatican. However, the Pope refused. Ironically, as the Pope lost temporal authority of the Papal States, he gained supreme and absolute authority over the entire church. Pope Pius IX decreed in 1874 non expedite, which forbade Catholics from contributing to Italian political life, and died in a self-imposed prison on the 7th of February 1878. Pope Pius IX would eventually become a beatified saint in the year 2000. In summary, we witnessed the rise of the Neo-Ultramontanists, the three popes of the time, such as Pope Pius VIII, Pope Gregory XVI, Pope Pius IX, the rise of industry, the Pope's feud against lemonade, the doctrine of the Immaculate Conception, Risorgimento, the First Vatican Council, and the doctrine of the infallibility of the Pope. Thanks for watching, and join me next time, whereby I talk about the papacy tackling a whole new world, chapter 3 of Absolute Power by Paul Collins. Thanks for watching.